Well, in fact, I mean, we typically think, unless we actually sit down and read his arguments here, we typically think, okay, freed from the law, well, isn't that nice for Paul? Yeah, let's go send our daylights out. Doesn't he realize that we need to live holy lives or dot, dot, dot? Yet Paul seems to be making the whole argument here, you don't understand how the law works. Every time I go back to the law as the measure of my acceptance before God, every time that happens, it stirs me up to disobedience. You imagine that more law is going to fix this.
Yes.
That's your first problem.
Yes.
Actually, the gospel that you think will take away any motivation for holiness
right.
is the only thing that can give a basis for holiness.
This one thing, if we could get that one thing across to Christian believers of all stripes, your intuition here is wrong.
Mm-hmm.
That is, not only is it true that to add more law will compound the problem, ironically, the opposite is the case. That is, if you really want, just greedily, to just have a better moral life, you'd do better by believing the gospel if all you wanted was the results.
Yeah. Right.
That's really ironic.
There's irony to that because right. it comes to every one of our minds. Mm. Good grief, I know what would happen to me if I were released from the law. Mm-hmm. I'd go crazy. And to try and get across to somebody, the thing that keeps you from doing that isn't the law.
Yeah.
It isn't. It's only the gospel that does that.
But the religion of the law, as Paul practiced in his Pharisee days, gives a deception. It deceives you into thinking that you've actually met the requirements
yes.
of the law.
Mm-hmm.
And I think one of the strongest arguments for the fact that Paul is referring to his present Christian state rather than his pre-Christian days when he talks about the struggles here is when you look at how he describes himself before his conversion as it relates to the law, he said he was perfect.
Philippians 3. Yeah.
Philippians 3. Yeah. According to the law, he was, or as it relates to the law, blameless, which is very similar. And it wasn't just him, but this was the Pharisaical thinking.
Yeah.
That's the Pharisee. That's the plead of the Pharisee or the actually boast of the Pharisee that Jesus speaks of in the temple. It's the conclusion of the rich young ruler. Mm-hmm. What does the law say? Oh,
right.
I've kept it from
it,
a youth up.
Since I was a kid.
And that's how one views oneself through the law or in relation to the law if you mm-hmm. are if you have a religion or a law-based religion.
Yeah. And he says the whole point here is to marry us to Christ instead of the law so that we will bear fruit. He says in verse 4, we've died to our first husband, the law, and have now been married to Christ, he says, to him who was raised from the dead, that we should bear fruit to God. In other words, as long as we're married to the law didn't rise from the dead, the law didn't suffer for our sins, the law has no life in it. Christ does. He was raised from the dead. He is the life-giving spirit, Paul says in 1 Corinthians 15. Mm-hmm. So being married to Christ means we actually have the life that was promised by the law, but which the law itself couldn't give.
Yeah. And what the law does do, verse 5, for when we were controlled by the sinful nature of the flesh, the sinful passions aroused by the law were at work on our body so we bore fruit for death. So when we were married to the law, unbeknownst to the person married to the law, it's the law that generates this sinful desire and sinful passions. Paul will go on to say, I wouldn't have known what coveting was if the law hadn't said, don't do it. So the law, all the while, we think it's the standard of righteousness that we've attained. It is killing us.
Yeah. And think of that just in terms of our children. Everything was fine yesterday until my kid walked past the cookie jar, and I said, now don't touch that.
Mm-hmm.
I don't think he was going to touch it until I said that.
Right.
And this is what law does. Law heightens, not because the law is bad, but because that just shows how evil we are.
Oh, yeah.
It's the theological equivalent of a wet paint sign. You know, stick a wet paint sign on something you want. Mm-hmm. That's exactly what the law does. That's exactly the way it works. And the more people talk about, now, don't do that and don't do this. And, you know, people are really doing this and some really do. All of a sudden, there's this strange desire inside mm-hmm. to want to do the very thing, even if it repulses you.
Yep.
Mm-hmm. That is our rebellious nature.